Okay.
And then it says the false teachers are hirelings. Why? Because they aren't feeding the sheep. They don't care about the well-being of the sheep. What did Jesus tell Peter? Feed my sheep.
Amen.
He says the hireling flees and the wolf snatches them. Why? Because he won't guard them. The hireling won't guard the flock.
Amen.
Every pastor is called to be an elder who guards the flock, just like those elders in Acts 20 were told to do so.
I agree.
And it's a serious responsibility.
Okay, I think that wraps that part of it up. Let's move to 1 Timothy. You made a comment, a headline in your paper, said, Paul's warning comes true. What's that about?
Well, he warned the Ephesian elders that after he left, wolves would come.
Yes, he did.
Well, Timothy, Paul wrote to Timothy quite later, all right?
Yes.
And sure enough, the wolves had come to Ephesus. That's where
By
Timothy
the way,
was.
Did they have names?
Yeah, it was a guy named Hymenaeus and another named Alexander.
How would we know that?
Because Paul named them.
He named them out loud. My goodness, isn't that amazing?
Well, we're told not to do that because people don't want to follow the biblical pattern.
Okay, let's pursue that and find out why. Okay.
Well, he says that they, some have rejected and suffered shipwreck in regard to the faith. Among them are Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I've delivered to Satan, that they may be taught not to blaspheme. The reason false teachers are dealt with publicly is their teaching is public.
Public. Yep.
That's where ideas are debated. As we said last week, when people were teaching that you have to be circumcised to be saved, that was publicly debated because they were publicly teaching it. Where this rule that people made up came from, I don't know. But they're saying false teachers can teach anything they want publicly in the church to the flock, and if somebody corrects them, the one correcting them is the sinner.
Amazing.
Mind-boggling.
Oh, it's amazing. Okay.
How deceived people are. But
okay, Paul's reminding Timothy of something here and in chapter 4. Now.
Yeah, here's what he says in 1 Timothy 4 and verse 6. He says, in pointing out these things to the brethren, what are these things? Well, the true teachings and the warnings he gives here and so forth. You will be a good servant of Christ Jesus, constantly nourished on the words of the faith and of the sound doctrine that you've been following.
Let's cover those two things, the faith and sound doctrine.
Well, when you have a definite article with the word faith, it concerns the content of what we believe.
Perfect.
Okay? So the faith once for all delivered to the saints that we're supposed to contend for. Doctrine is teaching. I know people often use the term doctrine like it was a really bad word.
Yes.
Well, we don't want doctrine. Well, the word doctrine simply means teaching. And I remember having a discussion with a pastor and said, well, no, we don't have doctrine in our church.
Oh, really?
And I said, well, do you have somebody in the pulpit and their mouth is moving and words are coming out? And he said, well, yeah, we have sermons. I said, well, then you have doctrine. Doctrine is teaching. You just, what you're saying is you don't have biblical teaching.
Bingo. Okay. There's actually an admonition in 4:16, 1 Timothy 4:16.
Yeah, listen to this. It's very important. Pay close attention to yourself and your teaching, or could translate it doctrine.
Doctrine, yes.
Persevere in these things, for as you do this, you will ensure salvation both for yourself and those who hear you.
Ah, it's two parts.
Right. There's salvation is at stake. This isn't just some nitpicky thing. You know, I've heard people say, well, why do you care about all this? What's so important? Why do you care about what's taught or what's preached? And aren't you just being picky? Well, it says here that salvation's at stake, according to Paul.
Amen.
So we should care. Does it matter who Jesus is? That's the doctrine of Christ. The doctrine of Christ, that phrase, by the way, in the genitive in the Greek, can mean teaching about Christ, which the Bible provides, or teaching from Christ, which is also the message of the New Testament.
Didn't know that.
Depending on us, the objective, subjective, genitive, but both things are true. We need to know what Christ has taught, and we need to know a true doctrine about Christ, who he is, and all of the implications of messianic salvation.
Well, it's interesting. In the paper, you pick this up, but even as you read it, when you say for yourself and for those who hear you, what he's pointing to is the teachings have consequences.
Absolutely. Wow. They always do.
Wow.
Any teaching that's not from God, that we think is from God, is somehow defining for us a God we didn't know.
Exactly.
According to Deuteronomy 13.
Paul got back to this issue in his second letter. He wrote Timothy a second time.
Yeah, and he says basically he prophesies that a time will come when they won't endure sound doctrine, but having itching ears, they'll keep on themselves teachers. In other words, they will find people to teach what they want to hear.
Yes.
Okay. But what does Paul give as the antidote to that? Preach the word in season and out. So because they don't want to hear sound doctrine, his prescription?
Sound doctrine.
Right.
Preach it.
Give them what they don't want.
Yeah.
Sound doctrine. Why? Because sound doctrine will correct us. It'll encourage us. It'll do a lot of wonderful, gracious benefits in the lives of believers.
How would you do a quick summary of this one?
Well, Paul's prophecy came true. Some of the elders actually became the false teachers, which he said from among your own selves.
Yes, he did.
But Timothy was there to correct the situation, to withstand the false teaching, to correct, reprove, rebuke, exhort, and get things straightened out.
And in your paper also, you said basically it's teach the true doctrine, correct the false doctrine, and protect the flock from the wolves. And I thought, man, that's a great summary.
Absolutely.
That's what this game's about. Okay. We actually have something out of Galatians, too.
Yeah, I'll just quickly mention that rather than getting in depth. But in Galatians, you can read where Peter fell into hypocrisy.
Yes.
And refused to eat with the Gentiles when the Jewish people from Jerusalem came.
Yes.
And Paul saw it and went and publicly rebuked him.
Wow. And that's a close brother.
He said, I rebuked him before all.
Yes.
Why? Because it wasn't a secret. Everybody saw what was going on.
Yes.
So the two or three witnesses weren't necessary because they had the whole church as a witness because it was happening right there.
Let's move towards some kind of a conclusion here so we can draw all this together. I'm going to want to hear a little bit from you about what we can judge, what we can't judge. But where does conscience and liberty come in this whole thing?
In Romans 14, it talks about not judging the opinions of the weaker brother.
Yes.
But at issue were things that weren't absolutes or dictated in the Bible.
Exactly.
Some eat meat, some eat vegetables, some have different days of worship. And he says, don't judge.
Don't worry about it. Yep.
So we're not to be judges of things that God hasn't declared to be true or false or sin or not sin. Or, let's put it another way, things that are rightly within the realm of Christian liberty.
Perfect. Yep.
If it is a matter of Christian liberty, then we can't judge it.
Yep.
Because if we do, we make ourselves a lawgiver, and it's a sin to try to be a lawgiver.
Okay.
God's the only legitimate lawgiver.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It wasn't too long ago somebody sent me a thing rebuking me and calling me a sinner because I preached out of the New American Standard Bible.
Oh, boy.
And I had to preach. If I didn't preach out of the King James, then I'm a sinner. So I just wrote back and I said, well, you made yourself a lawgiver and God doesn't like us to be lawgivers. He goes, well, how am I a lawgiver?
Yeah.
Well, you just say I have to use the King James Bible because you said I have to.
Right.
And if I don't, I'm a sinner. That's making yourself a lawgiver because there's nothing in the actual Bible, which was written in Greek and Hebrew, that says, thus saith the Lord. You have to read the King James.
Sorry, that's liberty.
So therefore, you're making yourself a lawgiver, and that's a sinful thing to do. So thank you while I use my New American Standard.
Okay, what can we judge, what can't we judge, and how do you wrap this up?
Make it real simple. We can judge what we can know. We can't judge what we can't know. Here's a summary that I wrote. We can and must judge what we can know objectively, but we must not judge what we cannot know objectively. Ask yourself when you make a judgment, can I know this with certainty? If the answer is no, we cannot judge. If the answer is yes, and the issue concerns biblical doctrine or sin, we not only may judge, we must judge.
Outstanding.
And if we do not, we imperil our own souls and the flock of God that he purchased with the blood of Jesus Christ.
Absolutely perfect. If somebody wanted to read about what we've just been talking about, what would you reference them to?
Well, if you go to cicministry.org,
yes,
and choose articles, and they're listed there in order of publication. This is issue number 94, May, June 2006, and it's entitled Discernment in an Age of Deception, Defining the Believer's Biblical Call to Judge.
Well, Robert, I think this was an excellent discussion. I think it's going to be helpful for some folks. So, people, I hope that you enjoyed it as much as I did. All right? That's it for today. For those of you who might want to contact us or visit our church, we are Twin City Fellowship in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Our telephone number is 952-935-3100, or you can find us on the web at cicministry.org. For Critical Issues Commentary, this is Dick Cuffell
and Bob DeWay.
See you next week.